Thank you very much. Thank you, Lisa and Ned. Good to have you with us today. Those that are joining us online, welcome. We're glad to have you as well. We have a lot of folks here today that we would like to make special connection with, but I don't want to embarrass anybody, so I'm not. But if you look around, there's just a lot of folks here, some that we've been praying for, others that we've been missing. And so as you look around throughout the service and then at the end of the service, make sure that you nestle up alongside of somebody and let them know you appreciate them being here today and that you've missed them, have been praying for them, and that you love them. Stand with me if you would today on this Father's Day, and let's lift our voices together in great harmony to this wonderful song, Thy Word is a Lamp unto My Feet. If you're not familiar with the song, make sure that you just look at the words. I know that you'll be familiar with it.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed.
Such comfort we have in knowing that you walk before us and lighten the way. Lord, forgive us for our nature of always wanting to walk away from the path, thinking with self-confidence that we are able to light our own path and find our own way. We get grievously lost, usually injured. And there in our sorrow and our shame, a light finds us and leads us back to the right way. How gracious, how good you are, my Lord. And we thank you for being our light. I pray today as we focus on this Father's Day, the many men whose consistent light has lit the light and path for their family. I pray that honor might be given to them today and that they might receive it, not in some weird, proudful way, but in a humble way of knowing that they did with intent and were able to accomplish the task. Father, thank you for the fathers and all the contributions that they've made into our life. I pray, Father, that you'd honor them today as we seek to do so too. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Thank you very much. I already got my Father's Day card today. This is from Anna Lynn. And she gave me this card that says, Happy Father's Day, Pastor John. Hope you have a good day from Anna Lynn to Pastor John. Did I just embarrass you? Oh, I'm sorry. And what a wonderful card that was to receive. When I was laid up at home, couldn't do much, I got these cards. It's everybody in the church sent cards. And one of the cards came was from Anna Lynn. And I opened it up, and it had her signature on it and a message. And it meant a whole lot to me to get that from you. I aggravate her every time she'd go to junior church. Sometimes she would stick her nose up in the air at me. But it's always nice to know that someone appreciates you. And I love you, and I appreciate you too. All right? And she even gave me a little twirl today. Oh, no. There I go again. And so it was wonderful. We want to honor our dads and to acknowledge their presence in our life. I realize when you have a Mother's Day or you have a Father's Day, sometimes that's almost as tough as it is enjoyable. Because not everybody had the best father and not everybody had the best mother. Or your mom or your dad's no longer here and it's just a tough day for you. But I don't mean to make it tough for you. I do mean to honor our moms and our dads on the respective days. I told my mom the other day, we were sitting talking. I was drinking my coffee, and she had already had hers. It was on her fifth or sixth cup. I don't know which it was. But I said, isn't it interesting when you look back, you don't see all the negatives. You see the positives and the contributions. My dad didn't do everything right, especially when he whipped me all the way home. But when I look back, I see the things that he did that made me today. And those that knew my dad and those that know me would probably tell you if you wanted to meet my dad, you have to meet me. And what a compliment that is to realize that he so impacted my life that I bear in his absence his image and his love for God and his ability to do anything with whiteout and duct tape. There isn't anything he couldn't fix with whiteout and duct tape. Everything was restored whole. Amen. If he'd have been here, Aaron, you would not have had to get up on my roof. Amen. He would have fixed it with whiteout and duct tape. But today we want to honor the fathers. And if you are here today, Father, your kids are gone or maybe they're still at home. Would you stand so we can see and honor you here this morning? All fathers, stand with me. Yes. Amen. Amen. Look around. What a joy. Yes, sir. Amen. Thank you very much. I was going to say, who's the oldest father? No, we're not going to do any of that. The ladies like that, but us guys like to remain anonymous when it comes to those things. But there is a gift that we have for you, and if you go out that way, you'll be able to get it that way, and the flower committee will meet you this way if you're going out that direction. If you go out this door, you just lose. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Okay. So either this door or that door, we do have a gift in honor of Father's Day that we want to give to you, and we do appreciate what you contribute in our lives. I have this image in my mind. My dad, he worked at a factory. And I had a testimony for the Lord, and because of that testimony of the Lord, he got fired. And it really put our family in a tailspin. I've told you a little bit about that. But my dad went to work for a farmer that all they do is eggs. And for a little kid like me, that was the most fascinating job in the world. But if you're an adult, that's pretty humbling. You go around and find, collect eggs and chickens that have problems you destroy and all that kind of stuff. And he did that for a long period of time. And then someone that he knew, who respected the Lord and respected my dad, gave him a chance at an apartment complex, 52 units, I believe it was, that had gone into receivership, and they needed a manager for those properties. Do you remember what I told you? My dad, there isn't anything in the world he couldn't fix with duct tape and whiteout. And I'll tell you, he took him, Ben, and put him in that small apartment complex, and I've never seen so much duct tape and whiteout in my life, but he fixed everything and did such a wonderful job that company that bought that apartment complex and the management company that was involved in it offered my dad a job in Indianapolis, and then from there on and on. And so in the darkness of those few years or months, God was able to restore great things. Now, why am I telling you that? Because these doors on these apartment complexes would have one entrance door, and you open it up, and there'd be two apartments at the bottom, and then you go up a flight of stairs, and there'd be two apartments at the top. Pretty typical, okay? And those doors, those outside doors, you'd open them up, and the wind would come through in between those buildings, and it would pull the door clear off the hinges, a door closure, rip it clear away from the housing, everything like that. And my dad would say to me, "We're going to go fix that door, John." It was like 30 below or 40 or 60 below or 90 below. I mean, it was really cold, okay? 120 below. I don't know how cold. It was cold, amen? And I'm out there, and he'd say, "Hand me the Phillips." And I didn't know what a Phillips was. I'd hand him. "It's not that one, the other one, you know." It was always the other one. I never got the right one. And there I was out there. My knees were knocking for cold. My teeth were chattering because I was going to hand him the wrong tool, Rob. And I don't know how many. There couldn't have been more than 100 doors in that place, but we fixed 400 or 500 of them. I mean, it was amazing. But to this day, I know what a flathead and a Phillips head screwdriver is because of those doors. Amen? And so the impact that our dads leave in our life are wonderful if we'll look back and pick out the highlights of those good times. And they give us an opportunity to relive the past. I remember my dad, most of all, one fateful day. I need you to go aw every once in a while, okay? Like I'll do like this, and you say aw, okay? All right, let's practice. Aw, yeah, very good, okay? And so my next door neighbors, they had all the freedom in the world. My mom was scared to death I was going to drown in a dry bathtub, and I didn't do that yet. And so they always were asking me to go down to the creek, or crick, depending on where you were born. And one day I could not resist. I knew if I went down there I was going to get killed, but there's some things you're just willing to be killed for. And so I went down with these boys, and we went down to the creek, and they showed me you could turn over a rock, and there were things underneath the rocks. And I mean, I don't know how much time went by, but man, we were turning over every rock in that creek. And we'd made our way right underneath the railroad trestle. And the railroad track ran right behind our house. And I was down there turning those rocks over. And my dad, whenever he'd want to get me, he had this whistle. You could hear it in New York. I mean, it was like loud. And I was turning over those rocks, having a blast. And I heard that whistle, and it wasn't far away. And I thought, oh. And I looked up. And there he was standing on the top of those railroad trestle with his hands behind his back. That's another whoa. Thank you. Okay. And he said, "What are you doing?" And I thought, well, if he asked a question like that, it might not be as bad as I think, you know. I said, "We're looking for crawdads." And he goes, "Did you find any?" I said, "They're all over the place." And he said, "Good. I think your mom's got dinner ready." And the tone of his voice, I thought, this isn't so bad at all. He's a pretty neat dad, amen? So he said, "Well, come on up here." I said, okay. So I walked up the side of this cliff and banked to get up to the top of the railroad tracks. And then he brought that belt out that was behind his back. I think it was about 165 miles back to the house. And I'll tell you, it's an art to be able to run on top of railroad, what do you call those things? Ties. But I learned it like that quick, that art. And I mean, I was going like this, running frogs, whoosh, 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 whoosh. Whether any of those hit me or not, I was crying like every one of them got me. I was crying out. If anybody was watching that, that was a sight. If they'd had movie projectors back then, they would have been taking videos. Amen. But I was crying like I was being killed, and he was whipping me all the way home. And we got home, and he sat down, and he gave me that story. Now, John, I only did that because I love you. And I thought to myself, I wish you'd love me less. Amen. That's a little bit too much love right there. Amen. I remember that like today. I've gone back to visit that site, and it's probably not even a quarter of a mile, the railroad track, to the house. And the railroad track trestle isn't as long as this pew, but I thought it was like forever. And the creek, my mom would be so happy to know, you would have to find a real deep hole and fall face first for it to even cover your nose. Amen? But I mean to tell you, she was scared to death I was going to drown. That's the reason she didn't want me down there. But the memories that we have of our dad and what they do to us later in life. I haven't taken a bath since that day. I mean, I'm scared to death. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. All right. Our fathers, they leave such an impact in our life. And you know who seldom ever realizes the impact they're leaving? Is the father. But they do. Marla, do you have any impact in your life from your father? Amen. Okay. Yeah, okay. On Facebook. Okay, well, look, yes. Oh, great, great. I'm glad I asked her. Aren't you glad, Ed, I asked her? Amen. So this Father's Day, we honor you fathers for the impact that you have in our life. And if you're here today and you still have kids at home, don't ever forget, more than you will ever know is the impact that you leave in their life. As you leave, don't forget, get your gift on the way out. When we think of fathers, we think of friends. The last thing I did with my dad was my poor little wheelbarrow broke, and he took it all apart for me, and he died before we put it back together again. And I've had the privilege of putting that back together. And every time, Rob, I grab a hold of those two handles and I wheel that wheelbarrow around my property, it's as if Dad's right there with me. So they such an impact in our life, and we don't ever want to take you for granted. We think of the friendship that we have, and this song talks about that friendship that we share with our Father in heaven, the Lord Jesus Christ. Stand with me, if you would, 435 in your hymn book. 435. In Drew's absence, Lisa and Ned are going to play music for us, and we'll sing along with them.
Thank you.
seated. And now, the Inside Out Band, Lisa and Ned, for special music. Much. Well, 488, stand one more time. I understand they have a real long-winded preacher here, so stand so you can stretch your legs a little bit. Sing this last stanza of this song, He Keeps Me Singing. 488, we'll dismiss the kids to junior church at this time. Thanks, Glenda.
Is that my cue? Yes. There's a fire down there.
seated. Thank you very much, Ned, Lisa. Appreciate that. Pardon me? He's not been ornery. Oh, he's been ornery? Oh. Amen. 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 Well, thanks for sharing that. Appreciate that. Amen. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles today, I invite you to turn with me to Psalms 127, Psalms 127. Enjoyed the singing today, enjoyed seeing people that we haven't seen for a while and those that we've been praying for so much, and always nice to see that. As hard as it is to believe, 3 years ago, this is my beginning of my fourth year here. And that's up. Time goes by so quickly. But 3 years ago, we began a four-part sermon on the significant role fathers place in our life, stemming from the analogy of the Bible text that we're about to read. Psalms 127, beginning in verse 3, it says, "Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth." The psalmist speaks here of children as being arrows in the father's hand. The picture is of a father carefully and skillfully guiding his children towards an intended target. I should probably say that I got all my technical notes from Ben on hunting. So if they're wrong, blame him. No, I'm just kidding. But the goal here is to carefully and skillfully guide their children toward an intended target, just like a hunter with his arrow. Using this analogy, we are seeking to find instruction and encouragement as fathers as we guide and direct the lives of our children. Of the 4 points, we've considered 3 so far, and Andrew said to me today, "No one's going to remember what you said 3 years ago or 2 years ago." I said, "I'm going to tell them again." And he said, "Oh, okay, in that case, maybe they'll get a refresher course." So I'm going to say the 3 points quickly. A good father is skilled and strong. Spiritually, a father must be skilled in understanding the Word of God, an understanding he received himself from regular daily devotions. Your kids will never ever rise above the spiritual level that you present to them. If they don't see you reading your Bible and you don't read your Bible, don't be shocked and surprised that they don't read their Bible. It doesn't work if you do it 2 days out of a year or 4 months out of a year. It has to be the regular attendance of yourself as an example of shooting an arrow skilled. Ben, let me ask you a question. I know I'm kind of massive, but if I went out with a bow today, having not shot one in my entire life, what are the chances I'm going to get a bullseye? Why not? I'm not skilled. And so, you like the massive part, right? Okay. For a father to be able to shoot the arrow of their child with intent and to be skilled, they must be skilled themselves. to give the instruction to their children. Not only that, he must also be strong. That's determined and resolved. I don't know how many of you are like me, but every year and throughout the year, I end up setting myself some goals, and then I end up kicking myself for not keeping them. It's so much easier to make the goal than it is to keep the goal. But with a father, if the intended target is ever going to be reached, then they must be not only skilled, but they must be strong. And that means every day you do the same thing. You're determined, you're resolved to walk in the precepts of God's word. Honest, submissive, principled. And if you ever attempt to shoot an arrow with a bow of any accuracy, then you will understand the first sermon of skilled and strong. Secondly, a good father shapes and sharpens his arrows. Arrows are to be straight and their points are to be sharp. Of course, arrows don't naturally come this way in the raw material. They must be fashioned by design and engineering. God's word for a father is the blueprint on shaping and sharpening his children. And we are admonished to use this book, not a book by some psychologist somewhere. This book is the one that we're to use. But not only that, as a good father, skilled and strong and sharp, sharpens and shapes their children, but a good father sees and sizes. That is, he first determines what the ultimate goal for his children should be. According to the word of God, of course, this would be the bullseye of the target. And then he makes continual adjustments, whatever is necessary, as he evaluates the arrows are landing on the target. Now, contrary to what I said, I have shot a bow before. And when I shot a bow, the first four or five arrows went into the hay. They missed the target altogether. And so I started adjusting things. Do you have one of those bows that do that? And I started adjusting my sights. And I tried to make sure that my release point was always the same and everything was the same and my breathing was the same. And I can remember watching those arrows trace towards the target. You would have thought I won the lottery when I finally hit the edge of the target. I mean, I was like a milestone, amen? And I kept doing what I needed to do to get that arrow to come down to the center. They didn't always hit there, but that's always where I wanted them to be. And I was always trying to get them there. And more of them were landing there than they were astray. Because I was seeing and sizing. I was making the adjustment. I focused on what the target was. And I kept making adjustments to get there. A good father, skilled and strong. A good father shapes and sharpens. A good father sees and sizes. Today I would like for us to focus on the final point of a good father. A good father shoots and sends. Now, I didn't mind the other three sermons. Myself, I like them. I like the content of them. I like to think, okay, that's good admonition, John. I want to live that in my life. I'm glad that my kids like sports. They do like sports. But I don't want their life to be sports. I'm glad my kids like hunting and fishing. But I don't want their lives to be hunting and fishing. I'm glad my kids like cars. In fact, I'd like them to like them a little bit better whole than in parts, okay? But I don't want their life to be about cars. I have one goal for the three precious boys that God gave me, and that is that they would love God and serve him. I don't care if they graduate from Hale, Harvard, or they don't graduate at all. But I want them to love God. I want them to love God with all their heart, with all their soul, and with all their might. And I have given my entire life with them in it, with that intent. I clearly see the bullseye. I have made adjustments when necessary, I have an intention that's deliberate in their life. But this shoots and send thing means that you let go of the arrow. And that's hard. A good father shoots and sends. Now, I've talked to a lot of bow hunters whose skill level in hitting the target is excellent. I'm not one of them. And most of them use that skill to accomplish their goal. But I have talked to at least two hunters who, to their own shame and sadness, have told me they have been in the position, imagine this, Ben. They have pulled back. They have it sighted. It is in the perfect position, and they can't let go of the arrow. After the intended target moseys on down the road, they could shoot themselves. But at that moment in time, they just froze. They couldn't let go of the arrow. May I say to you this morning, if you've enjoyed the privilege of children growing up under your care, then you understand the passionate remarks of the hunter who told me, I just could not let the arrow go. Few hunters have this problem, but every loving and caring father struggles with letting the arrow go. The struggle centers, it seems, around two specific issues. One of releasing, and the other one on reliance. And I'd like to talk to you about those this morning for a little bit. First of all, the releasing. Children grow up and the day comes when they, like arrows, must be released. To my three boys' lack of desire, on the side of the wall on my office, I have a picture of the three of them when they were much, much younger than they are right now. They hate that picture. But it tells, you parents, it tells a story. That picture tells a story. And I look at it often, Ben. And 20 years from now, you'll know exactly what I'm saying. But it represents something to me. It represents a time of innocence and of unchallenged love and adoration. And every once in a while, I have to look up there because it's not the same anymore. And I have to look up at that picture and just say, there was a time when it was like that. All those years of instruction and interaction, all those years of care and devotion, all those years of them thinking that you were the only person that lived. Suddenly, the arms that once raced to embrace you and latched onto your neck and legs for comfort and joy, now let go. And in some cases, begin to push away your embrace. It's a struggle, to say the least. But it's also inevitable. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 24, it says this, therefore shall a man leave his father and mother. I mean, it's important to understand this is the design of God. One day, Bo is going to walk away from you. It's going to crush you. It's inevitable. It's God's plan. Therefore, shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the twain shall be one flesh. God's wonderful design of family involves releasing and leaving. I'm reminded of that story in the Old Testament, Genesis chapter 24. You may be familiar with it. When Abraham became old and he asked his servant Eliezer to find a bride for his son Isaac. If you recall the story, Eliezer traveled all the way to Mesopotamia to the city of Nahor. There at a well, he prayed for God's leading and waited there at the well of water for God to answer his prayer. Eliezer, in a moment of time, saw this damsel, this young girl named Rebekah. She approached the well and she went to draw water out of the well. So Eliezer spoke to her and said, I have no place to go. Can I come home to your house? She said, yes. And it was this girl, Rebecca, dad, who was Abraham's brother. Eliezer spoke with him, and notice what it says in Genesis chapter 24 and verse number 58. Genesis chapter 24 and beginning in verse 58. If you did not have a Bible or you didn't bring yours with you, I put part of it up there on the screen for you. But notice what it says in verse 58. And they called Rebekah and they said unto her, will thou go with this man? Will you go with this man? And she said, I will go. And they sent away Rebekah, their sister, and their nurse, Abraham's servant, and his men. And they blessed Rebekah and said unto her, thou art our sister. Be thou the mother of thousands of millions, and let thy seed possess the gate of those who hate thee. Notice what it says in verse 61. And Rebekah arose. She left. Left Mesopotamia. Left Nahor. And she went to a place that they would not see her. It's a part of God's plan. They released her. They had to let her go. Some parents struggle so much with releasing, they never do. But God's design is to shoot the arrow. Is to release them. Is to let it go. And a good father shoots the arrow. I know it's a difficult task. But if you are skilled and strong, that is, in your parenting ideas and your goals, grew out of God's word, and in time that you spend in it, and you have spent your time shaping and sharpening that arrow, your children, to conform to the biblical desires that God commands, and you've been consistent in your instructions and your example in seeing and sizing the arrow, then you have to let the arrow go. You have to let the arrow go. I've tried to give my children a biblical focus of life. They have spiritual disciplines that I strongly encourage, but not mandate. I've tried to example the Christian life in front of them with relationship to God, to this blessed book, the world around me, and especially to their mother. I've tried to give them an example that fits the example spoken of us as fathers and husbands in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7. I want each of them to love their future wife and honor her just as the Bible instructs. I don't want to pass along the faults. I don't want to pass along the failures and the errors of generations who preceded me. I have had a biblical goal in my heart and have been focused and determined by God's grace to be able to let the arrow go. But I'll tell you what, I know a good father releases, but it's just hard to do. But a good father not only releases, a good father sends the arrow. When I speak about sending the arrow, that's involved in reliance. And this is really where the rubber meets the road. Let me say here, sadly, there are many more fathers who shoot arrows and few that send them. There is a difference. Shooting, as I have just mentioned, involves letting go or releasing a lot of fathers. In fact, have even shown the door to their children. But sending involves a premeditated, predetermined end or direction. The released arrow will travel and land. The difference between these two in shooting and sending is reliance. A hunter's reliance, correct me if I'm wrong, Ben, is about the arrow, the practice, and the proper equipment. If you practice, you have good arrows, and proper equipment and 20 years, you can get pretty good at shooting that arrow. A good father's reliance, however, is not on these things. A good father's reliance is on the command and promise of God's word. The promise of God's word. In Deuteronomy chapter number 6, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, chapter number 6, notice what it says in verse number 1. Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that you might do them in the land whither you go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments which I have commanded thee, thou and thy sons' sons, all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it, that ye may be well with thee, and that ye may increase mightily, as the Lord God of your fathers hath promised thee, in the land that floweth with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart. A reliance upon the commands and the promises of God. A parallel passage to Deuteronomy chapter 6 is found in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4. It says this, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. A good father's reliance is that they have followed the commands of God and they're trusting in the promises associated with those commands. Not only that, it's based upon the concepts practiced. I love Proverbs 22. Do you know Proverbs 22? Proverbs 22, train up a child in the way that he should go. That's the first part of it. It's the concepts practiced. If we believe God's word is true, and we should, then we take God's word and we take the concepts of God's word and then we practice them with our kids. A good father releases his children with a firm reliance that the instruction of God's word is both reliable and the practice of the concepts is dependable. And so they believe the commands and they trust the promises. They practice the concepts. And thirdly, they have confidence in the provision. Proverbs 22, 6a says, train for child in the way he shall go. Most of us love the last part. When he's old, he'll not depart from it. That's confidence in the provision. For the hunter, the provision is the equipment. But for the father, the provision is the child. God provided you with children. He made you stewards of their lives. He gave you an instruction manual called the Word of God, trusted that you would read it, trusted that you would implement it. And if you did these things, then you can have confidence in the provision. Now, you all look at me for a minute. I know it's painful. I have not always been what you see right now. And it's more than just what I'm wearing. But my poor mom and dad, I took them through misery. From about 13 on, I was just bent on being trouble. But at 19 years of age, they lived in the provision and the confidence in the provision. Train up a child in the way he should go. When he's old, he'll not depart from it. When I was out there in the middle of darkness and I knew for sure that someone was going to kill me, I started singing, stop. And let me tell you what the Lord has done for me. Stop and let me tell you what the Lord has done for me. You say, where did you learn that song? In Sunday school. I'm walking through these ammo bunkers. Deep and wide, there's a fountain. Anybody out there trying to kill me, they would have said, that guy's nuts. Leave him alone. he's already gone wacko. You know, I may never march in the infantry, ride in the cavalry. Shoot, we love the part of the shooting. Shoot the artillery. I mean, I sang every one of those songs walking around there. Train up a child in the way he should go. And when he's old, he'll not depart from it. Confidence in the provision. Could I say to you today, parent, don't underestimate the desire, resolve, and character of your children. Don't underestimate them. Titus, John, and Andrew have all gone over to people's houses that I did not know. And I have sat at home with my worry stone, scared to death I'm going to get a 911 call from them. If I knew they were like this, I'd have never invited them over. But Rob, is that the call that I got? What do they usually say? You all have kids. What do they usually say? And you say, who are we talking about? Isn't that what happens? You say, who? They did what? They washed your dishes? Are you kidding me? Did you ask them to? They did it without asking? Fill their forehead, quick. They may need to go to the emergency room. I just say to you, if you have done your best with this book to prepare your child to be released, don't underestimate the desire, resolve, and character of your children. Don't underestimate what God is able to do. The seed of God's instruction and your dedication to the task will produce. You don't put corn in the ground and get weeds, nor do you put weeds in the ground and get corn. If you planted corn, can I help you this morning? Wait and watch, because something's getting ready to come up. And it will be enabled. You have confidence in the provision of the Lord. Don't underestimate the desire, resolve, and character of your children. Now, children grow up and the day will come when they must be released and sent out. That's hard. Andrew's right there now. He's been there for about a year and a half, as far as I'm concerned, and about 4.5 years if you ask him. The reluctance to release is that you love them. And the reluctance that you release is that you don't want them to get hurt. But there comes a time when you have to say, Lord, I've done all that I can do. And I've tried to be obedient. And now in your hands, I'm going to rest and trust in what you can do. And there have been many a parent whose heart has been broken, not because God didn't do what he promised, but because their expectations were not the same as God's. Trust in the work that God is able to do. As men and fathers, let it be our aim, fathers, to send out our children with the godly skills and desires to emotionally leave home and handle life on their own. Now, in a church this size, we're privileged to be able to see children with their parents. Isn't it a blessing to see Marla reach over to her dad and be able to give a hug on him? Amen. And even though Ben didn't get someone lean over and hugging on him, I know they are in their heart. All right? Would you rather them be at the bar today, or would you rather them be here at church? So the benefits of the goodness of God. Our expectations might not have been exactly what we had in mind, but God is faithful if we shoot the arrow and we let it go. What God can do with that individual. Today, I pray, fathers, that you'd be encouraged if you're there to release and let go. I'm going to share a story with you just to show you how special God is. About 3 years ago, Carolyn's son, Tim, got out of the army. We were a church that had just gone through a lot of trouble, and I was the new, maybe to be, pastor. And Tim showed up and stood right over there with Carolyn. I went down, met him. I could tell right away. He didn't have to tell me he was in the military. I about saluted him. Amen. High and tight. Man, he was a picture of the discipline found in the military. And I have to admit, in my heart, I was thinking, another young man. This is great. This is what First Baptist needs, is some young people to pass the baton to. And Tim and I, we got to talking. And in the course of that conversation, Tim shared some things with me. And I said, well, over the last 30 years, I have mentored young men in a scope and sequence approach to ministry. And if you'd like to discuss it further, you can get a hold of me. He called me the next day. He said, what's this all about? I said, well, let's meet and look and talk. And so I shared with him the whole plan. He said, well, can we start tomorrow? And I thought, glory to God, not only is he youth coming to the church, but he's going to be a preacher. I was all excited. We met twice, and he said, found a house in St. Mary's, and I'm moving my mom, and we're all going over there. And I went, what? But for 2.5 years, with my heart broken, I met with Tim every Tuesday evening for about 3 hours, and we went through the mentoring process. I loved seeing him grow in the Lord. It was so fulfilling. It almost took away the pain that he wasn't going to be here. And then we finished. And I thought, your labor's not in vain in the Lord. Amen? But man, I sure wished he could have been here. And then Andrew went through some rough times in his life, as young people do. And I told him, I said, you need to reach out to somebody to hold yourself accountable to. Someone other than your dad. And of all people that he reached out to, he reached out to Tim. And Tim says, hey, I got this great plan. It's about a 2.5 year plan where I can mentor you in this path to ministry. And unbeknownst to me, what God was doing through Tim, and 2.5 years later, God would use Tim to speak to Andrew in a way he would never listen to me. Is that right, Andrew? Never listen to me. It's not personal. It's just a prophet's not without honor except for his own household. But God was able to minister to my son through the efforts of me ministering to someone else's son. And God's will was accomplished in that life. I just say to you fathers today, don't ever give up on your kids. And don't ever think that God's not totally involved in the work that you want to do. One day, you'll release and you'll shoot the arrow. And it may not look like it's going to the target, but one day it'll come back, a bullseye in Jesus' name. I pray that's your experience, and I pray that it'll be your blessing. This is what the psalmist said. The arrows are a heritage of the Lord, and we're to guide them to the target. Father, thank you today for your word. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being a father. Lord, our heart's desires is that they may grow up to love you with all their heart, their soul, and their mind. Lord, it may be through the valley of difficulties as it was mine. But God, you are able to do this great, wonderful work if we as fathers will dedicate ourselves to being skilled and strong to shape and to sharpen, to see and to size, so that we can shoot and send. God, help us to have the courage and the determination. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand with me if you would. Our last song is Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, 335. Thank you so much today for meeting with us in a dear and a special way. Help the fathers that are among us. Maybe their children have already left the nest, but they're never, ever not a father. Help them, Lord, to be an encouragement and strength to their children. Father, for those of us who are still responsible at home, help us, Lord, I pray, in our failures, to be strong in the power of your might. Father, help us to be dedicated to the task and to never cease and never quit. And then, Lord, we pray for our dear arrows as they are shot and released, sent away. God, you would be with them and use them in a way that you desire. We'll be quick to give you the praise and to thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Don't forget, on that way out or on this way out, please pick up a gift, our token appreciation of thanking you for being a father.